Engineering was always in the blood when I was even little. Pulling apart vacuum cleaners, cars, radios, I mean, just seemed to be in the blood, you know, engineering in the blood. And I came to North America for a holiday. And at the time, I worked for the research department of what then was the GPO. I would have gone back from the holiday, but while I was here, I was offered 3 times the salary. If it was 10%, I'd probably go back. But 3 times was kind of a heavy-duty uplift, so I stayed. And after 3-4 years in that job as the manager of applications in Microsystems International, traveling around the world, a lot in North America, I decided to have a go. Now, if you listen to me, you'll probably learn a lot. Because like 90, 89 companies, I continued to start up about 4 new companies a year. To tell you the truth, I could have retired about 1979 when Mitel went public. I was a pretty wealthy individual. I could have come to Florida, I own a home here, I could have twiddled my toes in the sand and just retired. Are you kidding? I mean, after about an hour, that's enough for me. I just have to get back in business because, frankly, I enjoy business. I enjoy growing business. I've learned a huge amount, starting with Mitel. Now, you will have seen, probably earlier, that my umbrella company is Wesley Clover. For some reason, not part of a strategy, when I invested $4,000, which I borrowed from the Bank of Nova Scotia in Canada, I had a home that had gone up in value, and I borrowed $4,000. And I started up Mitel with a guy called Mike Copeland. And for whatever reason, I went to a lawyer's office and I had to start up a little company that I thought was the right thing to do, a little holding, little umbrella company. And I tried to come up with a name that was unique. And I remembered when I was 6 years old playing in the grounds of the Wesley Church, where my family used to go to church, playing with my little friends and seeing a four-leaf clover. And I knew that that was a lucky thing, even at that young age, so I took it home. My grandmother pressed it into that family Bible, and it's still there to this day. So I just thought, aha, Wesley Clover. And it's been kind of a lucky thing for me ever since. I mean, out of almost 90 companies, I lost 6, but never had a bankruptcy, and always looked after the creditors, and always work with young people and bring them along, make them a next generation of business people, and we should all remember that. There's a next generation coming along. And in our current flat world, and I'll speak a little bit about that, because we live in a very flat world for many, many reasons. We have to fight around the planet against nations that are monsters. China, 1.3 billion people, average salary $1,000 a year. How do I know that? I hire engineers in China. I know what they cost. I know how hard they work. India, 1.3 billion people. There are no customs barriers. Communication costs. Many of you will remember you make a call from New York to Beijing, costs you $10 a minute. Now think nothing. No communication costs. No tariff barriers. And on top of that, shipping in containers is so automated. Click, 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 one end. Click, 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 the other end. Totally automated, has almost no impact in the cost of goods. And I'm damned if I'm going to see my children and my grandchildren simply working at Walmart selling Chinese goods. We have to innovate, we have to fight, and you can win. And I win time and time again by working with young people that come out of universities, and I help turn them into business people and have a terrific amount of fun doing it. So what did I learn? How come you can have such a high degree of success? Like, there has to be some stories in there that you can relate to that can affect you. Is it like a little mixture of chemistry that's very special to me and I shouldn't pass it on? One could argue, Terry, why are you telling people about this? They might do the same thing. You might get competitors. Okay, I'm happy to pass on the secrets of this little mixed juice that I pulled together, because it really is like a little chemistry juice that I pulled together that works time and time and time again. You imagine starting a company up with $4,000. You don't pay many salaries for $4,000. You don't buy much with $4,000. You don't get much inventory with $4,000. Even in 1972. So how is it successful? Connection with potential clients first. Not develop a product, work very hard, spend money, develop something because it's idea-driven. And most startups are ideas-driven. Somebody's persuaded to put funding in, a family, like friends and family, whatever, work incredibly hard, come out and find, well, actually, it's tough to sell. Customers don't want that. And that's a terrible track because you become martyred to it. Those people that were involved, whether the funders or whether the founders, they want it to work. They work even harder to get cash, work even harder around the clock. It was wrong from the get-go. That's the problem. So I never do that. That's what I don't do. I don't take in new grads from university and listen to their ideas. I don't do that. There's some very important lessons. Connection with clients first. Hard work ethic. No substitute for that. Team spirit. The team has to feel like a win. You have to explain to the team. It doesn't matter whether you're the CEO, the founder, the chairman, you could be all of those. But, you know, that's not what's important. It's the team win that matters to gain success. I mean, after all, it's about making money. Make money, have fun doing it, have the enjoyment of starting up a team and growing it, make it a global business. I was never, ever a corner store owner. I couldn't do that. That's just not my style. I like doing global business. I'm an engineer and I enjoy that. So let's talk about it. Work hard with connection with client requirements first. Put a team together, drive it very, very hard. Make sure there's alignment of interest through ownership. Whenever I start a company up, there's gotta be ownership in those team members. Then you don't deal with employees. I mean, employees are, they do something, get paid, it's netted out. That's what I don't do. Has to be ownership. I'd rather own 10% of something and have it successful than 100% of something that's useless. And by the way, if you want to be the chief, make sure that the team wants you to be the chief. If they don't want to, do something else. The team spirit is very, very important. The single most important word, persistence. So here I am, starting up a little group called Wesley Clover. Today, of course, it's pretty successful. I own about 6 hotels, I own some golf courses, sometimes I might play golf. I can play golf any damn time I like. I don't, but I could any time I like. In fact, just over a year ago, I ran the Ryder Cup. What an unbelievable success that was. It was held in the UK, some of you may have watched it on TV, but you imagine, when it was announced that they would look for the next venue, I suggested it be held at the hotel I got called the Celtic Manor. Ladbrokes, the betting firm in the UK, gave me 1% chance of holding it. Now you'll see some people, Carl is in here and some of the guys, that wear that little Ryder Cup hat that I handed them. There's a lot in that hat. Remember to have a go, and I had a go. I don't even play golf, for God's sake. But not only did I hold that event, despite Ladbrokes saying one chance in 100, it was the longest Ryder Cup since history, since 1926. It rained on the Friday. They couldn't complete it in 3 days. They gave me a 4-day Ryder Cup. It's never been more than 3 days. So I got a 4-day Ryder Cup. The sponsors loved it because they got 30% more time with over 1 billion viewers on television. 55,000 people a day. It was the longest and the biggest in history. What an unbelievable success from a guy that was given 1% chance to run it. Have a go and enjoy it on the way. Make sure you have a team that's fighting and you can win despite unbelievable odds.